Good evening, everybody. On behalf of Gyanadab, I welcome everybody today for the program Flights of Fancy. This program is being done under the aegis of Gyanpedia. Gyanpedia was started with the aim of sharing knowledge with the support of expert panelists. Each of our panelists are extremely passionate about their fields and bring us a treasure trove of knowledge. We like to call them our walking, talking encyclopedias. Before I go further and introduce Gaurav Nalkur, our guest for tonight, who's going to speak on the wonderful birds, the exploring the wonderful world of birds, I would like to explain what Gyanadab is all about. Gyanadab is a registered charitable trust and has as its mission and vision statement to celebrate literature, arts, and culture without the constraints of politics, religion, and activism. Under Gyanadab, we are doing programs in English literature via the book club every Sunday at 6:30 p.m. We do programs in Hindi and Urdu under the banner of Guldastaya Urdu Hindi. I'd like to take a minute to speak about Nityasha Foundation, which is our sister registered charitable trust, which works for children coming from the economically weaker section of society suffering from type 1 diabetes. These children require medicines like insulin, glucose strips, and pathology tests, regular pathology tests, including regular visits to the doctors. We request patrons who are attending the program to donate generously to Nityasha Foundation. I will put up a small screen to show you something about what Nityasha Foundation. Nityasha Foundation is a registered charitable trust suffering underprivileged children suffering from type 1 diabetes. This is the QR code for donating to Nityasha Foundation via Google Pay. This is the URL or the QR code for donating via Give India. All our URLs related to Gyanadab, Facebook, Instagram, and my phone number is there on the screen. I request you to take screenshots of these so that you can contact us and donate generously to Nityasha Foundation. I'll once again put the URL for Google Pay, for Give India. Give India is the portal which collects donations and supplies and sends it to Nityasha Foundation. These are our URLs. Moving on, it is my pleasure to introduce our speaker for the evening, Gaurav Nalkur. Gaurav is an avid bird watcher, passionate wildlife lover and conservationist. Gaurav especially enjoys taking children on trips to the forest. With a bachelor degree in microbiology and master's in biodiversity, Gaurav specializes in urban bird diversity. The fascination with nature and wildlife began during his early childhood in Zambia and has inspired him to make sustainable tourism his profession. Gaurav takes children on trips into the forest, inculcating a love of nature and spreading awareness about the desperate need for conservation of biodiversity. Now, without further ado, I present to you Flights of Fancy. Over to you, Gaurav.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you for joining us today, this evening. And thank you to Gyanadab and Gyanpedia for giving me the opportunity to share my passion with you all. So before getting into too many introductions, I'll start with my presentation. Before I get into what birdwatching is and why you should get into birdwatching, I'd like to tell you a little bit about myself. I've spent my entire childhood in Zambia, and I've been an avid birdwatcher and wildlifer since a young age. I'm qualified as a research biologist, where I specialized in bird behavior and urban bird diversity. I'm currently working in wildlife tourism and training to be an ecotourism specialist. And my goal is to use wildlife tourism as a tool to create and raise awareness for wildlife conservation. Luckily, through my profession and my passion, I've got to visit some very interesting places, key of which has been the many tiger reserves in India, where I've enjoyed admiring wildlife and learning more about it. Also visited birdwatching destinations like Keoladev National Park, which is also known as Bharatpur, more popularly known as Bharatpur, as well as a lot of places that are not very popular, such as the Jalana Leopard Reserve that's just outside Jaipur. So before we get into bird watching, just some basic information about birds. Many experts consider birds to be the last living dinosaurs. And in fact, their closest relatives are crocodilians, the group that includes crocodiles, alligators. The living birds, birds alive today basically, are classified into about 251 families. 112 of these families are represented in the Indian subcontinent. There are about 10,800 species of birds in the world. And of these, about 1,376 are found in the Indian subcontinent. So what is bird watching? If you look at the definition, bird watching is the observation and study of birds. And this is usually done with the naked eye or with the help of a visual aid such as binoculars or a spotting scope. Many times it's not just watching despite the name, but there's also hearing involved because some species are actually easier to identify by ear than by eye. And many times you will hear a bird before you actually see it. Why should we watch birds? So bird watching is a great opportunity to spend time in nature. So, you know, forget your everyday chaos for a little while. And being in nature helps you unburden stress. It'll help you socialize with like-minded people. It also helps you develop a love and appreciation for the natural world and its complexity. It also helps create an awareness of the natural world. And although this hasn't been studied very well, it can be actually lead to a sharpening of your senses, especially vision and hearing. And of course, it's very easy to fall in love with birds, especially the sights and sounds. So how easy is bird watching? Bird watching itself can become a complex activity later, but it's a very easy hobby to start. This is mainly because birds are all around us and we just need to keep our eyes and ears open. Most of us are already familiar with the sights and sounds of everyday birds. So sounds like quails or parakeets, we already know what they look like, what they sound like. Young children have a natural affinity for nature. The term for this is actually biophilia. I've noticed that a lot of young children are easily fascinated by nature and are very curious about learning more about it. And there are plenty of online bird watching communities to join, especially on Facebook and other social media. So it's very easy to learn from people who are more experienced than you are. So for example, how easy it is, this is a list of about 28 species that I've spotted in my home in the middle of Pune. And these are 28 species that I can easily spot. So apart from this, there are maybe about 10 or 15 species that may be, not very common or have only seen once. So getting your first list of birds is not at all difficult. So for example, you have the red-whiskered bulbul, which is a common city bird. Or you have birds like the Indian white eye, which is a little shyer than the bulbul, but it's also quite easily found. The Indian grey hornbill is one of my favorite birds in the city. And, it's a very large bird, very easy to spot. And you have winter migrants like the ashy drongo. If you have a compost pit in your house or in your society, spotting insectivorous birds that are birds that eat insects, like this white spotted fantail, is actually very easy. They come to eat all the insects that gather around the compost. And of course, one of my favorite sightings near home was this female shikra. Shikra is a bird of prey that's about the size of a pigeon. And it managed to hunt a bulbul right in front of me. And I mean, if you look closer, it's actually got the bird in its claws. A second really nice sighting was an oriental scops owl. This is a species that is actually not very common to India, Pune at all. And, you know, this was right outside my window. In fact, this photo has been taken with my phone, so it tells you how close it was. So what do we need to get started in bird watching? So despite all the things, all the misconceptions we have that you need a very powerful camera or anything, the main thing that you will need is eyes, ears, and patience. If you have all three of these, you are well on the way to becoming a good bird watcher. Of course, you'll need binoculars or some other visual aids. This is because birds are a little shy, so then usually a bit far away, and you'll need binoculars to spot them. A field guide is also a good investment. So this is a book that will have illustrations of birds of your region or country, and it helps identifying the birds that you'll see. So ideally, I would suggest a field guide that's easily portable and with good illustrations and ample information. Many bird watchers carry either a notepad and a pen, or now with your smartphone, you can use apps like Google Keep. So this is just to note down your observations. If you have a bird that you cannot identify, you can note down what it looks like. So it becomes very useful. So these are the three most common field guides that bird watchers in India use. The one on the extreme left, Birds of the Indian Subcontinent, is the one that I most commonly use. And of course, binoculars you'll need because birds are not going to come close to you. So any additional equipment, this would especially be true for a slightly longer birding trip, like a day bird watching trip. So you need a backpack to carry your water, books, and whatever equipment you're carrying. Comfortable and sturdy shoes so that you can walk around comfortably. If you are a photographer, then your photography equipment. And if you're someone who is very interested in bioacoustics, a sound recording equipment is also a good idea. So bird watching and photography. Many people have this misconception that bird watching and photography have to go hand in hand. Actually, there are only a few bird watchers who are photographers, myself included. There are times when I won't carry a camera on a bird watching trip, and vice versa. There are very few photographers who actually know what they're clicking. But this said, it can be a great way to document what you see. And if you have a creative streak, it's a fantastic medium. The problems that you can get with bird watching and photography is, the main one is that birds rarely stay still. And you know, to capture great photos, you will need zoom lenses and good cameras, which can get very expensive. And again, weather conditions like fog, bad light, you're going to encounter this quite often. So if you travel with a group like me, this is a common occurrence where somebody will get into your frame at the last minute while you're trying to photograph. Similarly, you can encounter very foggy conditions. So for example, this is a black-necked stork that I tried to photograph in Haryana. But again, heavy fog at 9 a.m. in the morning. And then you have subjects that are uncooperative, I would say. So we had a pair of beautiful Saras cranes in Bharatpur, which refused to lift their head up for a good photograph. I think they were too busy eating. So awareness through bird watching. Many people are still highly unaware of the birds that are around them. And we have a lot of social, religious, and cultural misconceptions of birds. An awareness of all this will basically give you an idea of what problems birds face and in environmental plight in general. So for example, everyone knows the national bird of India, the peacock, or to be more specific, the Indian peafowl. But very few will know a bird like the great Indian bustard. So bustards are grassland and desert birds. There are five species that are found in the subcontinent. The problem with them being grassland and desert birds especially means that grasslands and deserts are usually not given the same amount of appreciation that forests are. So very often these are the first habitats that are encroached upon by human development. So because of this, most bustards globally, not just in India, are critically endangered. And the population of the great Indian bustard, for example, in 2008 was estimated at around 250. And today it is possible that it's fallen to about 125 individuals. Similarly, you have birds like vultures. Again, we often have this misconception because they seem to be dirty birds scavenging on dead bodies. And so there are 9 species of vultures found in India. These are birds that are specifically adapted for scavenging. So apart from cleaning, what they do is they help keep diseases out of the food chain. And this is a very important tier in the ecosystem. So the reason we use the word ecosystem is because the natural world is a system. And you know, removing any part of that system is like removing a part of a machine. It's going to collapse and, you know, it's never going to function properly again. Most vulture species in Asia faced a massive decline in the 1990s. And this was mainly due to a drug called diclofenac. This was used as a livestock painkiller. And vultures who fed on the cattle carcasses or goat carcasses that were tainted with this drug faced the problem of weakened muscles, especially in the neck. So it was called limp neck syndrome. And as well as liver and kidney problems. And they also laid eggs with thinner shells. So all these conditions led to a population drop of almost 99% of India's vultures, Asia's vultures. And this is popularly known as the Asian vulture crisis. So one problem that came out of this, because everything is a ripple effect, is this actually led to a rise in the population of feral dogs. So, you know, stray dogs that have moved into wild areas. And, you know, so you, not only do you have increased human attacks by dogs, but feral dogs have also started attacking wildlife. And, you know, they also spread diseases to related species like wolves and jackals. We also have a lot of cultural misconceptions. For example, owls, we often see owls as ill omens and you know, they're usually chased, or you hear instances of them being killed or being poached for use in you know, black magic and things like that. So these owls are an amazing pest control. They often eat rats and other harmful insects. In fact, the owl is considered as the steed for the goddess of wealth, Lakshmi, simply because owls eat rodents that would attack grain silos. So in fact, they'd increase your income basically. Similarly, crows are known to be the smartest of birds and they have very complex social structures. A lot of people don't know that crows actually mate for life. And in fact, a previous generation of crows, a previous brood of crows that is, will actually help take care of their younger siblings. So they do have a very, very interesting social structure that we tend to ignore. On the other hand, you know, people will readily feed birds like pigeons, which, you know, transmit a lot of diseases. And, you know, it's given rise to the population in the city. We mainly give importance to the wrong birds. So where do I start when I want to get into bird watching? So it's always best to start bird watching at home. This is a great place to get familiar with your everyday birds, as well as observing their behavior. And if you're using a camera or binoculars for the first time, it's a great chance to get familiar with that. Once you move beyond that, a lot of bird watching and wildlife destinations are now well known, easily accessible. If there are places that are nearby, then I would suggest you visit them as frequently as you can. So for example, you have the ARAI Tekadi near Kothrud, and you know, we normally don't associate it as a birding destination, but you have birds like this yellow bittern, which is normally a very shy bird and hard to spot, and this is a regular visitor to the quarry on the Tekadi. So what are migrants? This is a bird you'll hear often when you start bird watching, especially from more experienced birders. So many of us know that birds will migrate for various purposes. The most common are the winter migrants, which are birds that migrate to warmer climates during the winter. Sometimes winter migrants will make a stop along the way. So these are called passage migrants. For example, there are a few birds that will travel from Siberia all the way to Africa. And in the middle, they'll make stops in various places in India. And similarly, there are some birds that will migrate during their breeding season to a particular breeding ground. So these are known as breeding migrants. So for example, this vernal hanging parrot is resident to India, but is somewhat of a passage migrant in Pune. And this is a parrot that is slightly smaller than a sparrow. So this particular individual I spotted about 20 kilometers outside Pune. So it's not even that far outside the city. The blue-cheeked bee-eater is another passage migrant that we get. So since it migrates to Africa in the winter, it's you can best spot it in Pune around September, August, end of August, September. One of the breeding migrants that we get in Maharashtra, and one of the most beautiful birds I've seen, is the Oriental Dwarf Kingfisher. This particular bird is from Karnala Bird Sanctuary near Panvel. And they will migrate in the monsoon to the Western Ghats where we are. And they breed normally along streams and waterfalls. And many times you won't see them at all, except when they come out to catch prey for their nestlings. The common greenshank is a winter migrant for us. Winter migrants usually you will see are much duller than the other birds. And this is normally because when they migrate, they will lose whatever colors they need to attract mates. Basically, instead of wasting that energy creating pigments in their body, they will use it to give flying strength, basically flying stamina. So one of my favorite destinations to go bird watching is Bighwan. Bighwan is very popular for greater flamingos that come and visit in the winter. And many people will go there and just look at flamingos and come back. But it's also home to a lot of other beautiful birds, including the painted stork, gray herons, great egrets, birds like the Asian openbill, which is another type of stork, or the Indian pond heron, which is one of the most common wetland species in India, or the Eurasian coot as well, which is a very interesting bird to observe, and the Indian cormorant. And if you're lucky, maybe you'll get something slightly rarer, like a knob-billed duck or a great stone curlew, which is also known as the great thickney. Another favorite destination of mine is the Little Run of Kutch. And it's a landscape that looks like this. It is a saline desert. And this just goes to show that birds are everywhere. This is not a place at first glance where you'd think there'd be a lot of birds. But the little bushes that you see may be hiding a short-eared owl looking for shade. The wires might have Indian rollers that are sitting there looking for insects to feed on. And you get a lot of other birds like Eurasian hoopoes, red-wattled lapwings, gray francolins, and the red-wattled lapwing's close cousin, the yellow-wattled lapwing. And also cute little birds like the Indian silverbill. And like I said, I've had the opportunity to travel quite a bit through central India, especially Penj, Kanha, Bandhavgarh, and the Panna National Parks. So So of course, these places are very popular for tigers, which is more what most people would come for. But there's also a lot of beautiful birds there. So like changeable hawk eagle, crested serpent eagle. The white-rumped shama is a common bird in Kanha National Park. Malabar pied hornbill. Orange-headed thrush is another bird you'll commonly see on the ground. And there's a lot of other wildlife as well, like butterflies. And there are also places of great cultural beauty. So if you are in Bandhavgarh National Park and you have a safari in the Tala zone, I would suggest you ask your driver or guide to stop at the Shesh Saya, the beautiful statue of Vishnu. Similarly, Gir National Park, popularly known for its lions, also has a good population of leopards and other mammals. But is a great place for bird watching. So you can look for dry area birds like the jungle nightjar, the Tickle's blue flycatcher. Look in the trees for Indian scops owls, red-naped ibis. Indian pitta is another bird that you can easily spot there. As well as other interesting animals like the soft-shelled turtle. Recently, I had the chance to visit and work in a place called Panvot. This is about 15 kilometers from Nainital. And you get some amazing birds there, like the streaked laughing thrush, white-throated laughing thrush, black-headed jay, greenback tits. So this particular individual, you can see, has a caterpillar in its mouth, which it's actually carrying to its nest to feed its young. You also have birds like the whiskered euhina, black-throated bush tit. And if you're in a place with a lot of flowers, you'll also spot a black-throated sunbird, which usually comes to drink nectar. And of course, there are larger birds like the Kalich pheasant. And also birds like the gray-winged blackbird. The best thing about these birds is they are extremely common and very easy to spot. And these are birds that we'll never spot in the rest of India. So for example, this gray-winged blackbird, I was actually with my local guide there. And when I was clicking this photo, he was asking me, iska photo kyun khich rahe ho? Ye to bahut bade hai. Kachre ki tarah phaile hain sab jagah. And again, you have interesting cultural observations regarding birds as well. So for example, you have barn swallows that people will allow to nest in their shops. Because there is an idea that if you allow these birds to nest in your shops, it will give you great income. So normally I will not suggest you take photos of nesting birds, but this was taken from very far away and none of the birds were disturbed. So once you've gotten into bird watching and once you've started bird watching, what can you do next? How do you take this further? So there are a number of activities that you can actually pair with bird watching. If you have a love for trekking or photography or painting also, I know a lot of people who do beautiful wildlife art. You have the opportunity to travel to great destinations like I've just shown you. And in these places, you have a chance to observe and learn more about other wildlife apart from birds. This can develop into a career. Wildlife research, wildlife tourism are both fields that are growing in India. And this would be a great opportunity to get into them. You can also experience interesting cultural sites and anecdotes. And of course, the little things that you can't measure. So how every nook and cranny becomes a possible surprise. And once you get seriously into bird watching, every holiday becomes a bird watching holiday. You can go to Panchgani and Mahabaleshwar and look for birds in the Mapro Gardens if you want. Or a trip to Goa means you can look for seashore birds along the beach. So regular observations are a great way to study birds and develop a scientific mindset, especially for children or young adults. Science is all about recording religiously And, you know, it's a great way to develop this mindset. There are also a lot of citizen science initiatives. eBird is the most popular ones, one of the most popular ones. So what citizen science does is they will take data from everyday bird watchers. So for example, I'm a bird watcher. I go to some place, I record the birds that I've seen today, and I'll put it up on this portal. And wildlife conservationists can actually access this and look at this data. And, you know, they can use this data to reduce bird distribution, or if populations have gone up or gone down. Similarly, many illegal activities, things like poaching and sand mining, have been reported only thanks to bird watchers who have noticed this. You know, these are things that probably would have gone unnoticed. And bird watchers are that perfect middle ground between a conservation professional and the general public. So you are the perfect liaison between these two groups. And of course, you learn one thing, that dull birds are not boring at all. For example, this little bird, spotted flycatcher, doesn't look like much, doesn't look like a very interesting bird. But this is a bird that is a passage migrant, like I said before. So normally it should be seen in Rajasthan and Gujarat around August, September, October. This particular bird was in the middle of Pune city for about 2 months, December and January. And this was this bird was not shy at all, very bold, allowed you to get very close to it. Similarly, you have this bird that looks very much like a house sparrow, but is in fact a bird called the Sin sparrow. So best place to see this bird is the Sultanpur Wildlife National Park in Haryana. And how house sparrows are bold and will actually approach you, this Sin sparrow is a very difficult bird to spot clearly. It always stays in the bushes, rarely comes out. So in conclusion, what I want to say is that bird watching is a very easy hobby to get into, especially for children and young adults. And the benefits of this activity are countless, and they're often unique, unique to the person. You know, what I feel is a benefit for bird watching may not be the same for someone else, and they're unique to the place as well. And like I said, the career scope that stems from bird watching is truly promising. Both research and tourism are, you know, emerging fields, and they're very promising. And of course, it's one of the easiest and most fun ways to develop an appreciation for nature, and a great way to give back. So I'd like to thank you all for joining me for this presentation. Wish you all happy bird watching. If you'd like to get in touch with me, I'm available on Instagram as The Birdman Chronicles. So, you know, feel free to drop me a question, or, you know, send me a photo if you want it identified, or if you want any help regarding bird watching. Thank you.
That was great, Gaurav. And I'm sure people have appreciated a lot with your talk. And I've been getting a lot of messages on the chat group. And there are some people who want to ask questions, Gaurav.
Sure.
Bari, I'll just request some people to start speaking. Some people. Now, Anandita Chatterjee, she has, I'm allowing you to speak. Anandita, would you like to speak to Gaurav?
Yes.
Yeah, please ask your question.
Hi. I actually have inculcated the habit of bird watching because I stayed in a very green and small town as a child. But however, you know, the sounds of different birds chirping were the ones which I got used to. But here in Pune, I have planted in my apartment a few trees, which is a mango tree and all, and I keep on seeing birds. But, you know, my problem is that not essentially that we remember, bird comes for only a split second. So for us to observe it and then understand what bird it was becomes tough. I see a lot of birds coming even to my terrace because I have a mango tree, I have a papaya tree, I have a guava tree in my own little terrace, which is an apartment. So how do we, in that split second, how do we figure out what bird it is and, you know, and it's difficult for me to run back to a book or something. I mean, how do we do that to start with?
Thanks for your question. Actually, this is a very important point. So like with any skill or any hobby, you know, you're not going to be an expert at the first shot. You know, tomorrow, if somebody takes up, there are very few people who can remember, like you said, that split second sighting. So what I would suggest is, you know, sit with your binoculars and field guide next to your window whenever you have time. Just observe the birds, even if they come for a split second, you know, just make a quick note about, you know, what color they are, what size they are, what they were doing, how they sounded. And, you know, over time, it becomes easier and easier. It's not something that, you know, everyone can get into immediately.
Does recording a sound make things easier? Because, you know, sighting a bird and recording every bird is a distinct sound. So Maybe if we cannot catch a glimpse, if I record the sound and, you know, if I can hypothetically send it to you that this is the bird I couldn't see, but I heard the sound, then can you be able to figure out what bird?
Sure. That's actually, if you can manage to record the sound, that would be great, actually. Like I said, a lot of birds are seen more than they're heard.
Okay. Gaurav, I have one very senior person, Ms. Dr. Arash Barucha. I would request Arash Barucha to speak.
Farooq?
Yeah?
Can I say a few words?
Who's there?
Mr. Kannan.
Kannan, please speak, please speak. Kannan is my classmate from school. Kannan, please speak.
Yeah. Gaurav, I really enjoyed your presentation. Every visual was a learning slide.
Thank you.
I'm an intensive bird watcher, and I would like to share one or two of my experiences with you, as well as the lady who asked the question just now about recording a bird sound and then asking you. Well, that itself is another science, because the sounds of the birds, capturing them and trying to imitate them and then trying to call them so that you can see them is something that I have observed when I was in Borneo, went for bird watching. We took an expert bird watcher with us, because we are all amateurs. You know, I am an amateur. I don't know. Let me talk for myself. I'm an amateur, so it's very difficult for identifying birds which like to stay away from humans. So what the only way we used to get it done was, he used to play a record from his mobile and or a contraption which he had, and then make it sound as if he is calling the bird which he wants to see, because he knows the bird is somewhere around there from what he has heard. And then we could spot it, and then we could try and photograph it. This is what we had experienced. So I thought, you know, I should mention this to you, because I didn't see that particular experience of yours. But I think you made an excellent presentation, and I think everybody should follow whatever you have said about birds, because that's the only way we can start loving nature more than we are already doing. Thank you so much, Gaurav. And
thank you.
I would like you to share this presentation with us, so that, you know, when we feel a little lonely and down because of the stresses around, it will give us a little bit of peace of mind to go through some of these, so that, you know, we can sit and do some bird watching in the true sense. The bird watching that we did in school and in college are different. So thank you so much. Very nice of
you.
Thank you for organizing this lovely
doctor, presentation. Yeah, thank you. Is Dr. Barucha around? Can Dr. Barucha say something?
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Gaurav. That was good fun. Please keep doing this more often. You have to do this, because you need the large, large audiences to get oriented to this kind of thing.
And thank you so much.
Just a small comment for Kadanji. Kadanji, I'm one of the early people to do bird call recording in India. But I never play calls back to birds, because there is a question of whether you disturb their territoriality and so on. So two things that I don't do, and one of them Gaurav mentioned today, is I don't photograph birds at the nest, and I don't play back my own bird calls to them. So that there is a little disturbance that definitely happens to birds. Somebody else mentioned about birds and the distance to which I think they get disturbed. And there is a lot of evidence of how that works and how it happens in urban areas. So that's another thing to be careful of when you do bird calls or when you do photography of birds in urban areas. Thank you, Gaurav, I enjoyed that.
Thank you. So in fact, three things I would suggest never do, or you know, do it only in dire consequences. One is the call playback, like you mentioned. So this tends to disturb birds, especially when you know, they're trying to set up territory and all. It can have very negative effects. Again, don't approach or photograph birds that are on the nest. The photograph that I put up was taken from very far away. And, you know, these are birds, like I said, they nest in shops, so they're very used to people. Otherwise, I never would have. And the third thing is, don't try to, you know, just for the sake of photography, don't try to bait birds with the food.
Excellent. I would request now Purnima Athole to speak something. Purnima, can you say, unmute yourself and speak, please? Purnima?
Hello.
Yeah.
Yeah. Hello, everyone. And Farooq sir, thank you so much for arranging this very interesting Zoom call today. And Gaurav sir, you're excellent. And the presentation was too good. I just want to know, I have two questions in my mind that I always wonder that where we can see the dead birds. Means generally we can't see them dying on the road, or they are not well and they are dying anywhere at any places. So how do they die, and do they understand that they are dying? That's why they are they hide themselves somewhere else. And the second question is, can we talk with birds with the telepathy? Like whenever in the evening or at night, if we have any nest near our house and we want to talk to them, so is it the right time to talk with them?
I'm not very sure about the second question. I'll answer that first. But I would, I have noticed that many birds can read body language quite well. It takes them time to get used to you, of course. You know, you can't go out on your terrace and expect birds to come to you immediately. But there are a lot of people who have been regular contact with birds, and you have birds like crows and parakeets that will get very close to them. Regarding dead birds, it is, so birds obviously do die. That is the thing of every living thing. They normally die of sickness or old age, or sometimes they're eaten by other animals. So the reason we don't often see bird bodies is because nature has a fantastic cleaning service. You have crows or other meat-eating animals that will actually take the body away and eat it. Or, you know, sometimes they will die in places that you can't see. This is not a conscious decision, sir.
How can I speak now?
Okay, somebody speaking. Okay. Have you finished, Gaurav, answering, because somebody interrupted?
No, that's fine. I just wanted to say that, you know, most times you won't see a dead bird because it's been eaten by someone else.
Okay, okay. I have Alaknanda who wants to ask something, Gaurav. Alaknanda, yeah. Would you like to ask a question?
Yeah. Am I audible?
Yeah.
Yes.
Right. Gaurav, earlier in the presentation, you spoke about social structures in birds.
Yeah.
I wanted to know what that actually looks like, if you could sort of explain with an anecdote or example.
Okay.
And I have another question. I think in your intro, we heard that you do a lot of trips with children in order to inculcate the habit of bird watching. As someone who's also taught children, and it's very difficult to take them with devices, I want to know what has been their reaction and how many of them continue to follow it as a passion or a hobby.
Regarding social structures, so a lot of birds are, more, they have more going on than we know or that we see. So like I mentioned with crows, and you know, crows are a bird that's very special to me because I specialized in house crow behavior for my master's. they actually have one of the most interesting social structures. In that, let's say you have one breeding pair of crows. You know, they mate for life, so you can say a breeding pair, and they have a pair of a couple of chicks in one breeding season. The next year, when these parents are ready to mate again and, you know, ready to get their next batch of chicks, the previous batch are not usually sexually mature. And, you know, they haven't found mates or gone off on their own. So instead of just hanging around the parents or being fed, they will actually help to feed their younger siblings. So that is one example. Another example is in large gray babblers. So these are birds that can be found in the city. I think the places where they can be found is getting a little less, but they're normally found in large groups. And in this group, you will have a pair or one bird that is the sort of head of that flock. So these are the birds that will mate on priority. They'll get the best pick at the food, things like that.
About the children, Amanda, you asked anything?
Yeah, sir, I forgot the second question. Regarding children, like I said, children have a very fascinating, they have a very, love for nature. So it actually, whether they actually stay with it or whether they're fascinated by it, depends a lot on their age. Younger children I found are more, they're more likely to stick with bird watching after a bird watching trip. Teenagers normally don't. That's been my experience. But, you know, I've had instances. So, for example, I took a trip to Kanha National Park with about 5 or 6 kids who were not interested in wildlife at all. You know, they just wanted a holiday together. They were a bunch of friends. And, you know, maybe about 6 months after the trip, one of them called me up and, you know, said, you know, can you take me bird watching? So it really depends on what clicks with them. So older children, it's a bit more difficult. Young children, it's very easy to get them into bird watching.
Okay. We have Sanjay Saxena from Gurgaon. Sanjay ji, aap kuch puchna chahte hain?
Yeah. Hi, Farooq. Thanks. Can you hear me? Am I audible?
Yeah. Very much.
So, Gaurav, first of all, thanks very much for a lovely presentation. We really enjoyed it. I think it's, I really envy you to be able to go out to all these places and see the birds. I have a couple of questions. One is, whatever happened to all the sparrows? When I was growing up and I grew up...
Yeah, you have a watcher, madam.
Hey, you are here. We are on a webinar. So, you come inside. Bell matter.
Yeah, so Gaurav, when I was growing up, and I grew up in Jaipur, Jodhpur, and other towns of Rajasthan, there were always a lot of sparrows. And my mother would often tell us to switch off the fans so that the birds don't get hurt. They would be all over the house. But now I find that the sparrows have just disappeared. You don't see them. You don't see any sparrows anymore. So why has that happened? That is one question. And the second question is that, is there any app that one can download on one's phone for the purpose of identification of birds that we see?
So regarding sparrows, it's actually a combination of two main factors. One is the fact that newer buildings are not, sparrows don't really find them ideal to nest in. So it's not that the sparrows have disappeared, they've just moved away from the cities. If you go to a rural setting or a slightly wild setting, you'll see plenty of sparrows.
Okay.
So one is the buildings, building nesting, and secondly is regarding their behavior. So when sparrows look for food, they normally forage on the ground in open spaces. Mm-hmm. So what's happened in all these urban areas is all the open spaces that were previously, you know, either fields or open tracts of grass, they've all been concretized and covered. So it's basically a lack of nesting place and a lack of food that has kind of driven them away from the cities. The second question regarding apps, there is an app called Merlin that is easily available. I think it's available on both iOS and Android. Apart from that, you can look for any eBooks. So the field guides that I mentioned are normally available as eBooks, but they're not free. You'll have to pay for them. But the advantage is a lot of these ebooks will also have bird calls included in them.
I see. Okay, now one final third question. Farooq, sorry, I'm taking too much time. Which, you know, last winter, I saw a kingfisher near my house. Okay, and I live in a place where there is no water body anywhere close to us. Yeah. Now, that was a rare thing. I just glimpsed it once and I never saw it again. So if I want to see a kingfisher in a place where there aren't any water bodies, then what are my best chances? What should I do about it?
So the kingfisher you probably saw was a white-throated kingfisher. That's the most common kingfisher we have in India. And despite its name, it is a bird. I mean, the family is kingfishers, of course. But this particular bird actually very rarely eats fish. So, you know, they'll eat lizards. There have been instances of them eating smaller birds. They'll eat small bats. They'll basically eat anything. And fish is a very rare occurrence for them. Okay. So white-throated kingfishers are quite easily spotted in the city. If you want to look for kingfishers somewhere where there's no water, I would suggest either a place where, you know, there's a slightly open area of land. So basically where they can sit and look for lizards and frogs and small snakes and all to eat. Or if you are near farmland, so they'll quite often be found near farmland. Again, for the same reason that they can find all these prey animals easily.
Thanks very much, Gaurav. Thank you, Farooq.
Amanda would like to ask something, Gaurav.
Yeah.
Hi, Gaurav. Thank you so much for such an informative, delightful, interesting presentation. I just have a very quick question. In one of your response to one of the questions addressed to you, you had mentioned that most birds die because of old age. So what is the general lifespan of a bird or birds in general then?
So it depends on the birds. A small bird will normally have a lifespan of about something around 10 to 12 years. A larger bird can, you know, live up to 30 years. It's not generally known how long a bird lives. It's not a very accurate thing because a lot of these studies are done in captivity regarding age. What happens in captivity is these birds are facing almost zero stress in their life. You know, you have food given to them. They're not in contact with predators. So, you know, a bird that would live to about 20 years in the wild may even live up to 40 or 50 years in captivity. So it all depends on the conditions that a bird faces, really.
Right. May I comment on this, Farooq?
Who's that?
Iraj. Dr. Bharucha.
Yeah, Iraj.
Yeah. We don't know too much about lifespans of birds in the life, and it's probably very variable. But I recall once that Salim Ali was once asked a question about something which he wasn't very sure about the answer. So he asked me, is this what they are asking? And I said, yes. And he wanted to leave the audience, I guess. So he stood up and he said, well, gentlemen, to answer this question, I will have to go outside and ask the birds.
I think next time I'll have to use an answer like that.
Dr. Bharucha Dr. Bharucha is one of the most experienced wildlife photographers, and he's a very experienced person, Gaurav.
Yeah.
And I especially requested him to ask some questions because he's like an encyclopedia.
I'm quite familiar with this work. So.
Yeah.
I'll have to ask the birds that too.
Yeah. That we will call you one day to Gyanadab for a special program, Mr.
Yes, we should do that.
Mr. Bharucha, is it possible for you to write your phone number in the chat box? Because I don't have your phone number.
I think you have my voice, which is good enough.
No, I'll write it.
No, please write the phone number. No, please. Acha, Amar Yadwar is also an avid photographer. Amar, you would like to say something?
Yeah, good evening. Gaurav, a nice presentation. Really loved it. I have been doing bird photography now for quite a few years. Though I am an amateur, it's out of hobby that I picked up this bird photography. I move around Pune, and you did mention about Bijwan. So normally when we go to Big One, we go only to the water bodies around Big One. But recently, in one of my visit to Big One, I also learned that there's a forest around Big One, and where there are a lot of birds, different varieties of birds like Indian cursor, sand grouse, short toe snake, eagle, and lot many others. I would like to ask you, is there any list of such places? Because this is not normally available anywhere, I could not find. So is there any list of such places where we can visit, which are not known to many people?
So like you said, the grassland areas around Big One are very good for birding. Yeah. So if you're asking specifically about Big One, like you said, most people go to the water body, so it's not very well documented, the grassland area.
Yeah.
But if you want to look for grassland birds, I would suggest the area around, the area near Saswad. There is the Saswad and the Bhuleshwar temple. So the grassland areas around that. Again, they're facing a problem of human encroachment and human development. Or if you drive to the village of Supa, the Mayureshwar Wildlife Sanctuary is there. So this is about maybe halfway to Big One.
Mm-hmm.
So that's a very good grassland habitat as well. And they've got, it's a very good place to spot chinkara. And, you know, they've had reports of wolves and hyenas and jackals as well.
Yeah, sir.
Thank you.
That's me again. Yeah, Mayureshwar is a good place. The other place, if you are referring to big, close to Big One, about 35 kilometers from there, is a small black buck sanctuary called Rehkuri.
Yeah.
I have often found coursers there, sand grouse and whatever. It's a good place to go. So when you finish with the wetland, if you take the road to the left, it takes you down to a small place called Karjat, and from where you have this black buck sanctuary.
But do we have any list or documentation regarding all these places where we can find? That's the tricky part of it.
So if you're on eBird, it's very easy to find a list for these hotspots.
Okay.
Because quite a lot of birders have recorded there. So I don't know, are you active on eBird?
I have that app. I'm not very active on that, to be frank.
Okay. I haven't used the app that much, but on the website, if you log in on the website, there's an option where it says you can explore hotspots. Okay. So, you know, if you look for a place and open, it will give you a list of every bird that has been recorded there by eBird users.
Okay. Let me try it.
Yeah. So that would be a good place to start.
Yeah, thanks. Thank you very much.
Okay, next, I would request Kusum Gokarn to ask a question. Kusum, please unmute yourself and ask.
Yeah, I like the presentation extremely. I'm very fond of birds. Once upon a time, I used to keep lovebirds in my balcony. Now, one of my cousins has a suggestion that all of us should keep a plate of water for the birds in our veranda or in the compound. Because, you know, they are very thirsty, and sometimes in summers, they don't get enough water to drink, and that's how they die. So I would like to extend this suggestion to all the listeners. Thank you for your presentation. Extremely, what a lot of variety of birds we got to see. Extremely happy with all the colorful birds.
And Kusum,
Haji.
This program will be on Facebook Live. Immediately after this, it will be on the recording, so you can see those birds again on Facebook. And I would like now to request Leslie, would you like to say something?
Yeah. Thank you, Farooq. Gaurav, an interesting program. Very, very colorful birds.
Birds.
You can hear me?
Yeah.
So it was an interesting program. Very colorful birds and pictures. Excellent.
Thank you.
So I've been observing this crows, you see, and you are right what you said about crows being very social and having a family and all together. So just outside my window, there's this big silver oak tree, and a nest of crows was, they built their nest, and they hatch their babies in it. And it was very obvious, and it used to rain in a couple of months, 2 or 3 months prior to this, somewhere in June, July. And they were very protective. There used to be two birds, I used to always observe two of them coming, maybe the father and the mother, they used to observe, and till that baby, it was just one egg, till that baby grew up, and they allowed, they taught him to fly. And once he flew up, he went off. Now I've noticed that nest was vacant. Okay, it's vacant, it's nice and strong. Now I've noticed a few days ago, another nest just on the branch below. Nobody is using the earlier nest. So do the crows come again to the earlier nest, or, I mean, how is it? How does the social thing work?
So usually,
masters also include.
So usually when they come during the breeding season, they'll use the previous nest, usually, unless it's been destroyed or something like that. Sometimes they'll find a better location. So what I guess from your observation is that it's the same pair of crows. They've just, they just probably thought the lower branch was a better position. And they are very protective of their nests. My master's thesis was on house crow nests. And, a lot of times I had to wear a helmet when I observed birds because they'd try to attack me. But one very nice thing about crows is because they're very smart, they actually recognize people's faces. So, the first 2-3 times I was attacked, and after that, they wouldn't do anything to me at all.
I agree with you about them shifting the nest below, because the nest which was above, when the wind blew, it was so precarious. It was really, because in the before the monsoon, so the full tree used to shake from side to side, and I used to wonder how that nest is holding it to itself. So you are right. Probably they were afraid that that nest will break, so they have gone to a lower branch where it is much more stronger. Yeah, you are right. You are right. Your observation is perfect.
Thank you, Leslie. I would now request Anandita as my last guest to ask a question. Anandita, would you like to ask Gaurav anything?
Yes, hi. I actually remember that 2 times I have tried to rescue a bird which has come to my place. Once it was very small and we did not know how to do the process. However, there is no particular, we were browsing through sites to understand that how to save the bird, to keep the bird alive, so to keep the bird warm. And is there some basic do's and don'ts which somebody can do? If there was an incident which is very recent, when there was a small bird which hit our, a lot of birds come to my balcony, and apparently it was looking that the bird's wings are damaged. It was not letting us touch. It was not moving. So I touched the bird and I found the area of pain. The only thing I knew was to apply some turmeric, and I did that. And apparently the bird was sitting in my hand, but small bird. I have taken a photograph of that because I wanted to understand. She was very scared and shivering. I didn't understand. So I perched the bird on a little tree I have. And I obviously there's no way to understand, right? Whether the bird is in pain, how to take care of the bird. Is there some way, one guide, which is the basic framework of something when you see a injured bird, how do you take care of it? And second is that, this was one question which I had. And second is, like people said, okay, you send them to a bird rescue, do that, but you cannot really do that physically, right? So what is the thing, if you cannot take care, then what has to be done? If you, hypothetically, if a bird is there, and what needs to be done? Do you need to take a cage and keep the bird, or what exactly? We were very clueless. So we were hunting all around the net to find out that what should we feed? How should we keep the bird alive?
So I don't know if I'm the best person to answer this because I haven't had much experience with bird rescue as it is. Many times if a bird is outdoors, if it looks like a young bird that can't fly, its parents are usually nearby. So, it's always best to leave it alone. If it's something that has gotten injured or, has come into your house, normally it's best to take it to a vet. There are a few resources on the internet where you can where they'll give you a list of do's and don'ts. But again, I'm not very experienced when it comes to bird rescue, so maybe I'm not the best person to answer this.
Okay, so I think we will stop here because it's now cross 1 hour, and we have been really getting a lot of good inputs from you, Gaurav, and I thank you very much for your presence today and being so nice to all of us and answering all the questions so patiently.
My pleasure. Thanks again.
There's one question one last person is asking. Is Pashan Lake a nice place for bird watching?
Pashan Lake is quite a good area for bird watching. Unfortunately, it's a bit difficult for birders to get close to the lake now with the whole restructuring. But yeah, you can stand on the bridge, use your binoculars. It's a good place to look for ducks. It's a good place to look for cormorants. If you walk near the temple that's near the highway, it's you're possible to get quite a few warblers, and I think forest wagtail is being recorded quite regularly there as well. So yeah, it is a very good place.
So on this happy note, Gaurav, I will request everyone that. On behalf of all of you, I thank Gaurav for today's wonderful program. It was very knowledgeable, and I'm sure when children watch this program and they go on the recording, at least one person you have won over is me. I'm going to be a regular bird watcher. And to the users, I would like to give one suggestion which I discovered recently, that if you download the app Google Camera in your phone, and if you take any photograph of bird, the Google Camera goes on the Google and scans your image, and it can tell you which bird it is. So this is something you can discover yourself, and I found that's very useful.
Add one line about Google Lens. Google Lens can be a bit tricky because there are birds that are not found in India that look very similar to the birds we find in India. Yeah. And sometimes Google Lens will confuse the two. So it's a good first step, but I would always suggest a field guide and your own experience over that.
Chalo, theek hai. Gaurav, we'll take your inputs, and thank you very much. And on behalf of everybody, I thank you very much. And let me say a good night to everybody. And next week, we come with another program on Hindi Divas. There'll be a program on Kavi Yatra. The creators will be there on your WhatsApp and your broadcast groups on Facebook. Thank you very much. So Gaurav, thank you very much, and good night for everyone.
Thank you. Good night.
Yeah.
Thank you. Good night.